Yeah, thank you, Rico. As Rico said, I'm working in ambient intelligence, and so what is that? I put a picture here of an, let's say, a living room environment. It could be your living room. It looks like fancy, I think, a nice place.
It's not mine.
It's not yours. So in your living room, you might have installations already now. You might have electronics installed there. You might have sensors installed. You might have some intelligence installed in those in your living room. And so what I think of is you might have something like sensors for room temperature. So kind of change in the room temperature when it's getting colder. You might have sensors for light control. You might have sensors for security. So maybe you have sensors at your windows to control that nobody's getting in or what's the state of the window. You might have potentially sensors for your room occupancy. So who is there, where they are. And you might have sensors for potentially for daily activities. So what people are doing inside these environments. And so all of this basically is covered by the term ambient intelligence. So we are trying to make spaces intelligent, so kind of smart spaces, so that people can interact with the spaces and kind of have a reaction. So we might have services installed in environments, and we might want to interact with those environments. Okay, I will go back now. Before I'm going back, one prime example maybe are location-based services, which everybody of us knows a couple of years back. When you remember, we didn't have those, but nowadays it's kind of very well known, kind of a property thing for everybody of us. So, and it's really changes the game in many respects. So there's just knowing something on your situation, actually the location, where you are, like who you are, and where are services and maybe important locations around you, might really make a big difference for many businesses. You know, there's a lot of businesses actually built on these location-based services. And so my vision is that in a few years, we hopefully have the same maturity level also for ambient intelligence, that we can actually build services for smart spaces. So if there's a smart space, somebody could build something for me that I could install in my home and kind of utilize this service. Okay, but now I actually would like to move back a couple of years to see a little bit where I'm also coming from. So this is a video taking in 2011. This was a prototype system where, for the first time, we were demonstrating that we can actually use a very particular type of sensor. So I said we need sensors in the environment, a very particular type of sensor for sensing what's going on in the environment. So it's a little bit funny how Markus is running around there, but basically what we are doing, so we sense that he is actually walking from the electromagnetic radiation of these two antenna devices there in the back. We sense that he is walking around, that he's having a phone call, and we are also sensing there's a door in this room, so whether the door is opened or closed. So very simple things, also very, very simple features here, which we analyze there, but still at that time we could show that it's in a quite robust way we can actually understand what kind of activities are performed and what situation we see in some smart space in an environment. Yeah, and fast forward, we just recently submitted to the Ubicom conference. This is one of the two, I would say, major conferences in our field, where we demonstrate a similar type of sensor. This time it's a radar sensor. You see the radar on the left side of the picture, and what we also see is there's this is my group member. This is Darius. He is controlling the presentation here with his gestures. So what he's doing is basically that the radar sensor on the left side is capturing his movements. You see actually what the radar is seeing on the black screen. So you see clouds of points in principle. So these are points in a 3D space, X, Y, Z, relative to the radar. And so what we are doing then is that we interpret these point cloud and try to understand what kind of gesture is performed by Darius. And basically, we see this from this cloud of points. So there's some machine learning, some deep learning approach behind here. You see the architecture on the right side of the slides, because that's what we are presenting here. And we interpret these point clouds for gestures, and then are able to conduct some actions, in this case, to advance or to go back in the slides. And of course, you could install this also. You could imagine to have this in some sort of environment where we control maybe the lights, maybe the windows, or maybe some other installations inside kind of smart environments by just using, for instance, gestures. Okay, looking a little bit behind this, so what is it we're actually doing with this data? So you've seen there's these cloud of points. This is essentially, you can think of a LiDAR system. You probably, everybody has seen the output of these LiDAR systems, where you have a kind of point cloud showing environments, people. So what we have here is much more sparse. We typically have in one frame, we have about 3 to 10 points, so you can really not see any person from there. So in order to make sense of this, you have to look at this over time. So if you you can basically see the gesture from looking over these frames over time and how these point cloud evolves over time. So what we see here is a suggestion we had. So we proposed to use a basically to build from the point cloud a graph. I said this is X, Y, Z, and time, so we have a four-dimensional representation of these points. And we use some nearest neighbor technique here to build a graph over these frames, which evolve over time. And in this way, you can actually see the gesture in a sense. So it becomes the gesture becomes a graph over these points. And this we can then interpret with the graph CNN. This is a graph convolution neural network, which then interprets the point cloud graph representation as a gesture. Okay, and I would like to talk a little bit, give you an idea of what are the questions we are interested in at the moment. So one question you might imagine, if you have these point cloud representations, they look quite different. Let's say if the radar is in this direction, it makes quite a difference if I perform a gesture in this kind of orientation or whether I turn around and I perform it in this direction. But of course, in my home, I don't want to think about where the sensor is to do the gesture, right? But for the system, it makes a big difference in which orientation I'm kind of standing when I'm performing these gestures. So what we are currently working is to have a rotation invariant representation for point clouds so that we can actually have a much better recognition accuracy regardless of the basically orientation the person has relative to the sensor. So this is one of the questions. And another one, this is pretty much work in progress at the moment. So we are what you see here on the top, this is a X, Y, and the Z direction is actually the time. So there's five people walking in a circle, and we are trying to recognize them, to distinguish them, the trajectory and also the gestures they are performing from these point cloud representations. So what we are currently able to do, we can separate up to 7 people walking around in an environment in this case. So basically what you do there is some density-based clustering approach, which is applied here, and then what you might see in the end is like these individual trajectories which you see at the bottom there. And once you have the trajectories, you can go in there for the trajectories and do a gesture recognition, for instance, for each of them, so we can individually know which kind of different type of gestures is each of these people performing and where they are at any point in time. Okay, so many of you will know this and have heard of this. So now I've talked about using the RF channel somehow as a sensor, and normally we have this. We think normally of the RF channel as the radio frequency channel as a communication medium in a sense. But there's a lot of discussion going on at the moment about merging these. So can we have some joint communication and sensing? So can we integrate actually into a communication system the capability of sensing, so that's our one of our suggestions here. This was published earlier this year, where we proposed to use the sidelink communication. So this is a device-to-device communication capability of modern communication systems, where the device can ask for resources. And in our case, we propose to use the resources for sensing purposes here. So we can imagine that, our phone is in this way potentially turned also into a sensor for doing some sort of sensing. Yeah, when we think like this, then it means also that we have these, in a sense, you have sensors everywhere. So your phone is a sensor, your computer might be a sensor, your laptop, you might have a smart TV, which has a wireless interface, so this is potentially a sensor. So you have access points everywhere. So potentially there's, you have a smartwatch. So there's so many sensors everywhere, and this might feel a little bit scary in a sense. So it might be reminded of Big Brother in a sense that okay, now are these devices are somehow spying on me, right? So, and I think what is very important is that we also think about how we design these kind of technologies in a sense. In a way that they are like ethically compliant, so that they're actually not like spies, but that we can actually design them, that they are constraints and that they are design requirements to help like technology developers to design these systems in a way that they are actually that I can perceive this system as a helper. Right, in my smart space that I actually would like to use to interact with this technology, and not to perceive it as a kind of a Big Brother spy technology. And that's a project which will be starting in the middle of next year, and we will be devising technology and also design recommendations, not only for RF-based, but basically for any kind of environmental sensing systems which could be used in smart spaces. Yeah, and with this, I thank you very much.